All right, I'm here at Sonya with Dan Terminus. How are you doing today?
I'm super fine.
Are you?
I'm super fine.
How has the state been treating you this time around so far?
Very good, actually. Very good.
Okay.
Even the officer at the custom, you know, mm-hmm. when I got to the airport was super kind, super nice. Yeah, the states have always been a great place to go to, because this is the first time I'm touring the States, but I used to go to the States to visit my relatives and family, so I'm always fine with the States, always, except for the food. I'm so sorry, but I don't do junk food, and I did one terrible thing this morning. I tried Wendy's.
Oh God.
And yeah, I mean, I'm alive, I survived, but I'm never going to Wendy's again. Sorry about that.
I don't take offense. I can understand. It's just like a giant boulder in your gut after you're done.
That's the word. That's the expression. I couldn't have said it any better.
You began playing music at a pretty young age, from what I understand, and you were trained classically, not just in piano, but violin and something called solfège.
Solfège.
Okay. Is it safe to assume that your parents saw a lot of potential in your youth and pushed you in that direction, or did you yourself decide to be trained in that manner?
My parents actually pushed me into music because they felt like music was the right thing to do for me. And music has always been a very important topic for my parents. So they put me on a very young age on what we call in France, éveil musical, which is in fact music for kids. So, you know, you start banging on xylophones. And yeah, I did that. And this is one of the very few things I can do with ease in my life. You know, like, I can't even set the timer right on my telephone, but I can play a piano. So that's my burden, so to speak.
I mean, at least you have a smartphone. I still have a burner phone from 2001. So.
And that's a good idea, because I got a brand new phone and well, I'm not going to talk about that. Okay. Let's leave my flawed phone aside. But yeah, music has always been very important to me and to my parents.
So like many of your contemporaries, you were in quite a few metal bands before this project, and I understand that you actually sang in one of the ones that you started yourself. Have you ever tinkered with the idea of laying down vocals of your own on some of your tracks for this project without the vocoder and just doing your voice by itself?
Yes, and I gave it many tries, but I was not satisfied with the result. I don't know why, it's just that it didn't click. Mm-hmm. So I let it be, but maybe for my next album I will try adding vocals, but I'm still undecided about that, pretty undecided, because I like the way vocoder vocals or synthesized vocals sound to my ears. Mm-hmm. And I like my own voice, you know, I have no problem with myself, you know, I'm cool with that, but I haven't crossed that threshold yet. Maybe shame, maybe fear, maybe lack of skill, I don't know, call it whatever you want to call it, but no, vocals are not really my cup of tea for now.
So like with a lot of people, you said that one of your earliest exposures to the genre was with Hotline Miami, because I know you're a big gamer, right?
Yes.
But the group Noir Deco, you've said, served as your mentors while you were coming up. How did that come to be?
Okay. This is going to be a long and boring story, but I'm going to make it short and interesting. So I discovered this synthwave thing by playing Hotline Miami, and my attention was drawn to the track Miami Disco by my good friend Perturbator. And I discovered the scene, and long before that I was writing music on my old Atari 520 STE with a 4-track tracker. And I was writing very simple music, just to pass time, just to entertain myself, or to write music for friends who needed music for parties. And I was already hearing in my head tracks like the guys from Noir Deco do on a daily basis. So when I heard Noir Deco for the first time, it was as if I had found my soulmates in a way. Of course, I am not as talented as they are, but I reached out to them, you know, just telling them how much I admired their music. They replied to me, I mean, two members of the Noir Deco collective replied to me, and they helped me actually, you know, shaping my music. One of the members gave me general directions, and the other member gave me more technical aspects, more about EQ and stuff like that. And it helped me develop my own style further. But I know that sometimes, especially on my first album, it sounds a lot like Noir Déco, but all I have to give you is good faith. I promise you that I was hearing such music in my head before, except I didn't have the balls to produce it and record it and put it out there. The Noir Déco guys are very important to me. I think they are underrated today in the scene, and I think they should get much more recognition because they are the best. They are one of the best, in my opinion.
You mentioned the Atari 520 7TE and how you began producing electronic music on that first. What was it about that machine in particular that drew you to it?
It's a machine that I bought at the time because I didn't have enough money to buy an Amiga or to buy, Amiga 500 or to buy a Falcon, Atari Falcon, which was a machine that was dedicated to creation in the larger way. And I like the Atari because my first console, do you say that in English? Gaming console, you do? All right. Mm-hmm. So my first console was an Atari VCS 2600.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And it wasn't mine, it was my neighbor's. But I remained faithful to Atari after that. My Atari was the only thing I had to make music. You know, you have this four tracks tracker, you have your samples on floppy disks, you have Cinch output, you record it straight into a cassette recorder, and that's it, you're a producer. So, but, I mean, it happened with an Atari, but it could have happened with a PC or with an Amiga. But I do have a soft spot for Atari. Mine aged pretty badly, so it's now yellow. It's not gray anymore, but it still works. Before digging it up to write music, you know, the proto-terminus, it spent 6 years in a box in a garage. It was rotted, really rotted. I think there was even some mold on it. I plugged it in and it worked.
So obviously, like with pretty much anyone in the scene, Blade Runner has made a huge impact on you creatively. And I think you said in an interview once that you have like 7 or 8 copies of it, right?
That is true.
Particularly, there was a lot of influence with your album, The Darkest Benthic Division. Mm-hmm. And while a lot of others have created narratives of their own that have been inspired by that movie, you took it a step further by having the album revolve around a Blade Runner and a replicant. Was there any added pressure in the making that album to do the spirit of the film justice since they were so closely connected?
Absolutely not, because I'm very arrogant. I was just trying to write music that could be as respectful as possible to Blade Runner, the first movie. I never ever pressured myself to do anything. I just pressured myself to write something that was both stark and emotional. I think I did it quite properly. That's the best I can do to pay homage to Blade Runner. That's the best I can do. And I'm never ever going to do this again, you know. I just wrote this little story because I didn't want to redo the soundtrack. It's a perfect and beautiful and superb soundtrack. Nobody can beat it. No one. So there's no use in saying, okay, I'm going to watch the movie, mute the sound, and write my own score. No, I just said, okay, let's invent a story about a replicant and a Blade Runner falling in love, hopping on a boat and sailing away. It's as simple as that.
I know you featured Killer 7 in a track off your latest album, which I do want to touch on in a bit, but I have to ask, on Division, on the track Abandoned Ship Graveyard, there's a soundbite that sounds almost as if it's being spoken by, I think, one of the game's characters, Travis. Would that be too much of a stretch of a guess?
It is? Are you referring to This Is What I Live For?
Yes.
This is the purpose of living for those who have no life?
Yes.
All right, I'll let you check it out. But it's not Travis.
It's not, but it is from the game.
No.
Oh,
no. It's, in fact, it's again, it's a vocal synthesizer. It's just a vocal synthesizer. And I input the words in it, and the vocal synthesizer reads the word aloud.
Okay.
But it's not taken from Killer 7.
Okay.
But I can tell you more about Killer 7 after, when you get to the question about Killer 7.
Yes, because I do want to talk about that.
No problem.
The songs off of your other album, Stratospheric Canon Symphony, were originally composed with the intent of being used in an independent video game, but apparently the developers royally dropped the ball based on what you've said. Are you allowed to elaborate at all on what happened?
I can't. It's not a negative story, mm-hmm. and it's nobody's fault. At the time, the developers, well, one developer contacted me, and he was very interested in me scoring the whole game. So I saw the concepts of the game, the storyline, the characters, but then it was time to talk about the business side of things, if I dare say so. And I'm not a greedy person, I'm not a dollar-grabbing person, but there comes a time where I just couldn't work for free. Considering the amount of hours I had to sink into making this OST, I made a proposal to the game developers, and I never had an answer back, and that's when things stopped. But there is no hard feelings, and these dudes are cool dudes, they have a really good idea for their game, but that's where it stopped. The track that I wrote for this game is called Steel Clouds Over Iron Trees,
mm-hmm.
which is a good track. I still think it's good. And I had a few tracks lying around, so I started composing tracks that would be revolving around the idea of science fiction. But there is no story on this album. It's just science fiction. It's as simple as that. So, yeah, but no hard feelings.
You said that you regretted releasing it too early, and because you said that you had kind of released it out of anger as well, have you ever thought of maybe going back and releasing a remastered version of...
No, I don't want that.
Okay.
I don't want that. When I said I released it too early, it was out of anger because I said, oh, I worked on those tracks, I love those tracks, I want to release them. But it was too early. I just released the Darkest Benthic Division, and I had...
Oh, okay.
And I had a few, more than a few IDs ready for the Wrath of Code. So now that I see it, it's too short a time between the two releases.
Okay.
Especially for albums. That is the only reason why I said I released it out of anger.
Oh, okay.
Because now there's only me to blame, you know? But a lot of my friends in the scene tell me that it's a good album and that it's their favorite album of mine. I don't know what's wrong with them, but I don't know what has come over them to say that, but all right.
I understand that Peter Steele and his band Typo Negative has been a really huge influence for you.
Yes.
Is it true that your logo is inspired by their flag for the People's Technocratic Republic of Vinland?
Yes. Okay, short answer, yes.
Okay.
Long answer is I have a colossal admiration for what Petrus, or let's Peter, because Petrus is... Yeah, I mean, I didn't know him too personally to call him Petrus, so I call him Peter.
Mm-hmm.
I have colossal admiration for him. Mm-hmm. And I have always liked using green and black, because of Typo Negative and because of my personal tastes. And I wanted to find a symbol, not a logo, because I already have a logo, the Dan Terminus logo, mm-hmm. but I wanted to find a symbol that would be simple, but also not stark and stupid or childish. So I came up with this idea of a flag. And yes, it is reminiscent of the Vinland flag, but to me, it's my symbol, the Dan Terminus symbol. I'm completely fine with that. I have no problem with people coming to me and say, oh, you ripped Peter Steele off.
I'm not saying that.
No. I didn't say you did. Don't worry. But some people already told me that. So I prefer people telling me you ripped Peter Steele off rather than telling me your symbol is shit or is ridiculous. And Peter Steele said, rip off the best. So I'm just following Peter's words, which I'm sure he would approve of.
While the project for Stratospheric was meant to fall through, you've since been able to have your music featured in other works. You donated some music to a short film called, I'm going to butcher this, Dentes y Garras 2, your track Pegasus Pro Ultra Fusion was in the soundtrack for the game Blood Allied Reborn. Mm-hmm. But most notably, your album Wrath of Code was utilized for the 2016 game Neurovoider. Mm-hmm. How did that collaboration come to fruition?
The Flying Oak Games guys were developing Neurovoider, and every day they were listening to my music. Every day. And as they were alpha testing their game, they were alpha testing it with my music in the background, and they said, oh, it sounds cool. So they contacted me, and I said, sure, let's do this. And then they contacted Blood Music, and Blood Music said, sure, let's do this. And then the game was released. It's as simple as that. And I know them, I met them a few times. They're cool dudes, really. They have passionate heart for what they do. They really love video games and independent video games. It was a pleasure working with them, really. And I'm looking forward to working with them again.
In regards to your song titles, I usually don't make general statements in regards to these interviews, but you have some of the most creative and unique names for your music. Some of my favorites are Fathom Wanderers, Vesuvian, and Tokamak, which I looked up. And it turns out it's the name of a device that produces controlled fusion reactions in plasma.
Yes, it is.
Is there a process when it comes to naming your tracks, or do these names just jump out at you on their own?
They just jump at me. They jump at me depending on the mood of the track, or depending on what I hear, or what feeling I would like to convey. But it's a personal thing. But to me, the track titles are not like an accessory or something you wear around your wrist. To me it's important. I hear words in my head, or I do sometimes want to follow an ID, so I narrow it out until I find the words that are fitted.
Is it true that the opening song for Wrath of Code, Cherenkov Blue Overdriver, is a reference to F-Zero GX?
No, it's not true.
It's not true.
It's not true at all. It's a mix of two things. The Cherenkov Blue Overdriver is a mix of the Blue Overdriver, which is a cheesy name that I picked up for either a robot or a speeding spaceship. Mm-hmm. And Cherenkov is the Cherenkov effect. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you ever seen the core of a nuclear plant starting up.
I can't say that I have.
You're missing out. It starts to glow blue. I'll let you check out on the Cherenkov effect, because I know how to explain it in French, but I don't know how to explain it in English. But it glows blue. So I said, okay, Cherenkov Blue and Blue Overdriver, let's put this all together, and that's a cheesy name that everybody will remember.
Okay.
It's as simple as that, again. But I do play F-Zero GX
okay. On
my old GameCube, and I'm still furious at the game for mutualizing both the turbo gauge and the energy gauge. Mm-hmm. It's shared, it's mutualized. So if you press the turbo button all the way down, if you go kamikaze, you won't refill until you cross until you complete a lap.
Okay.
So, it's just a simple way to put it, quote, I suck at F-Zero GX.
I read that at one point you worked with a Japanese idol heavy metal band called Necronomadol. Can you please elaborate?
Ricky, their manager, who's a charming guy, really cool dude, is into synthwave. Mm-hmm. And he wanted to start an idol band that was different from the rest. So he did write a few tunes for them, black metal stuff. And he said, let's try to do something with synthesizers. So he sent me messages going like, would you like to write a song or maybe a few songs for us? And I said, okay, and I did. And it turned out great. So I sent him the track, and I also sent him the separate stems, you know, like kick, snare, hi-hat, bass guitar, distortion and everything. And they've been doing great. They've been touring Europe 2 times already. I missed them every time because I was sick at the time, and I regret that. I thoroughly regret that, because they do have this sort of Japanese dedication to working. even if working means being on the road constantly. It is a great collaboration, really. And I liked it a lot. It's funny because it was the first time somebody was asking me to make music that would be the shrine of human voices. I never did that. So that is cool for me. That's great for me. I wrote the track called Vulture. I didn't find a title. You know, Ricky found the titles. Mm-hmm. I wrote a track called Vulture, Azatoth, and Skull in the Stars.
I also heard that you live in a castle.
I used to.
You used to.
Used to, not anymore.
How did that happen?
Well, that's easy. At the time, I was with my girlfriend, and we were living in separate apartments. We were not living together. And one day she calls me and she says, "Hey, I found a place to rent in a castle." And I said, "All right, let's take it." So the next month, we move in the castle. And it's in my village, actually. It's still there. I lived there for 5 years. It's medieval castle, except the front porch was destroyed during the French Revolution. And one of the towers was, you know, when they take the stones away from the walls, mm-hmm. during the French Revolution. Ceilings that were 5 meters high, super tall windows, super low doors, you know, or thresholds, stones everywhere, big stone chimneys. And I used to live there. So to get to my apartment, you had to get in front of the castle, get through the porch, open a big wooden door with big, you know, patterns of iron and rust on it, and walk through a 500 years old stairs, walk all the way to the second floor, and then you have to knock on a big wooden door, and that was my apartment.
Is that like a normal thing? Are there a lot of castles that people live in France?
Actually, no.
Okay.
Actually, no. There are some people who live in castles. It's just, let's say, if the owner has enough money to maintain the castle, then you may rent a place there. And that's what happened to me, because my ex-landlord was a guy who had inherited this castle, and his ancestors bought the castle at the French Revolution. And they lived there. So basically my ex-landlord knows his ancestors all the way back to the French Revolution. The funny thing is that there was a neighbor who was living on the first floor. He was a very old man, totally deaf, stone deaf. And he was living in an old chapel. Chapel? Is that how?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, chapel that was repurposed as an apartment. There was this guy on the first floor and me and my girlfriend on the second floor and nobody else. So sometimes we'd go around the castle. There was a crypt under the castle. So I went there one time. It was used to store bottles of wine. And in the winter, when the snow was too heavy on the lines, we wouldn't get any electricity, no power. So we'd had to heat the house with oil heaters. And yeah, life in a castle, that was great. And life in a castle is good, but it's so sometimes also bad, because if you don't take care of a castle, if you don't maintain a castle, it will crumble like in 10 or 12 years. And the castle I used to live in needed heavy repairs. It was lovely, beautiful, elegant, superb, whatever, but it was also leaky sometimes. So we had to move to another house.
So I read that you have an official painter who does your artwork and album covers named Luca Carey, who did works for your last two albums and for your Reverie EP. He said that he actually reached out to you after hearing a song of yours that he described, and I'm quoting him here, as delightfully haunting while also a bit tongue-in-cheek. Do you remember what song it was?
Abandoned Sheep Graveyard. I don't know why. Yeah, but that's 100% Luca. Yeah, I can almost hear him saying this. Yeah, Abandoned Sheep Graveyard. That's one of his favorites. And but I think he likes Unfinished Cathedral as well. He's a great human being, really.
I mean, he sounds like he has an amazing work ethic, because I heard that on the last album alone, you said that he spent 300 total hours painting, and I genuinely don't know if you were joking or not when you said he almost went insane.
He was sincere. That was first degree, not second degree. And I think he toned it down a bit. What a fucking tongue twister. He toned it down a bit. because I think it's more than 300. He said he almost lost his sanity in the process.
That's why I was like, I didn't know if he was joking or not when he said that.
No, he's totally serious. When he's talking about his art, he's always very serious. When he sent me his portfolio?
Portfolio, yeah.
Portfolio. I was like, ah, the fuck? I had never seen crazy shit like this. There are very few people on Earth who can say, I know how to use colors. Luca is one of them. Luca is one of them. And let me tell you a funny story. You know, one day I asked him if he would be kind enough to design something for a t-shirt that I was willing to make. And I said, please, Luca, please, not 500 colors. Just, and he was like, okay, should I try like 100? And I was like, no, not even 100, just 8. And he was like, dude, this is so hard. And he said, okay, I use 12. No, Luca, 10 colors. And he did it. And it still looks as amazing as what he did with 300 colors. So this guy is a master at colors. He can take a blank piece of paper and cover it with colors you've never seen in your life. And you will look at it and you will go like, oh, wow, that's awesome. So this dude is a genius, a visionaire, a master at his art, a great human being, and a great soul as well. Very talented, a lot of culture, tongue-in-cheek as well, really. But he's a cool dude. But you should reach out to him and interview him, really. You will be surprised at his answers. Very elaborate answers, really.
I can only imagine, based on what you're telling me.
And if you interview him, tell him I say he can go fuck himself.
I'll be sure to start the interview with that. In regards to your last album, Automated Refrains, I understand that you were going through a bit of a bad time in your life during its creation. Would you be willing to open up a bit on that, or is that too personal? You want to leave that off the record?
Oh, no. I don't want to open up about that, but I can elaborate on that.
Okay.
Which is kind of opening up, in a way. It was, let's put it that way, working too hard at my daily job, personal problems and everything. But the good thing is that now that I look at it, it was a piece of cake when compared to what I'm going through right now, which is even worse. And I'm using this for the next album. I have started putting down some ideas, and it's going to be even, let's say, darker than Automated Refrains. And trust me, I've been through a lot of shit, really. I'm just going to give you one anecdote, and you're the first one to hear it. I burnt out, and I fell asleep in my car, and I smashed my car on my neighbor's wall. I don't look at me this way.
No, when was this?
Sorry?
When was this? Is like this a recent thing?
Yeah, this year. March.
I'm so sorry to hear that.
No, it's okay, don't be. The burnout is one of the best things that has ever happened to me in my life, because it helps me refocus on what's important.
All right, back outside. Again, in regards to Automated Refrains, unlike a lot of other cyberpunk-inspired albums, the story takes place after the machines have taken over and humanity has been wiped out. Was this a conscious choice to make yourself stand out from other cyberpunk fare?
Absolutely not.
No? Just story went?
It's just where the story went. Okay. There are two explanations for that.
Mm-hmm.
And they complement each other.
That's, yep.
Yeah, okay, right. I still have problems with phrasal verbs, I'm sorry.
I mean, I don't know a lick of French, so I'm not judging you.
Thank you very much. I don't blame you. And okay, so the first idea was to be like a tribute to the game. The game's Nier Gestalt and Nier Automata, which are two games you should play.
I got Nier Automata.
Well, now you have to play Nier Gestalt or Nier Replicant, which is the Japanese version, but it's still a masterpiece. And the second reason was because it sounded pretty natural to me. I didn't want to write a story again about evil technologies taking over the world and man questioning its own existence in a world where they are augmented. Who gives a shit? It's been done before. William Gibson did it way better. And it's not because it's been done before that we should not do it. It's just that I didn't find this interesting. It's as simple as that again.
Why do you think this angle in particular hasn't been approached by many others when creating sci-fi narratives?
Because people,
sorry, I didn't listen to the end of your question, but because people don't like dereliction. People don't like being abandoned. And in a way, you don't like negative things. You have to see the light at the end of the tunnel. And what I did with Automated Reference was presenting a world in which there is nothing left. Just a vague, distant, and kind of blurry image of the creators, but that's it. And it's just to explore a condition, in a way. A human condition applied to machines. So to be honest, everything is in the motto of the album, which is pity for the perceived lifelessness, which is in fact never truly lifeless. That's my only explanation. I hope it's a satisfying answer.
All your answers have been very satisfying.
Thank you.
You've got that French poeticism about you.
Hey, I gotta live up to my reputation, you know? I gotta be a poet in the United States of America. Smoking cigarettes, huh? Doing my best to impersonate Robin Williams impersonating the French. Everybody cut off your balls, you'll be quicker. You can build a Disneyland next to Paris. We won't go, but you can do it.
You stated that the track Grimoire Blanc, I hope I'm pronouncing that
Grimoire
right.
Blanc.
Grimoire Blanc, okay.
In French, or Grimoire Blanc in English.
Okay. I'm very uncultured. You said that that track was the sort of centerpiece of the album as it touches on many quandaries in regards to the relationship between man and machine, but the one I wanted to touch on in particular was the way that we as a species have kind of seen fit to use them for petty and degrading purposes, like using them for sexual gratification or just sending them into space, never to return. From your perspective...
Isn't that something I said?
It is.
I remember saying this.
From your perspective, do you think that we're making progress in terms of having people treat them with decency? And if not, what would you say needs to be done in order to change that?
That's a difficult question. The way I see it is humans will be humans. And it's easy to play God. And we want to, in a way, we want to play God because what is better in life than recreating life? Just to amuse ourselves and entertain ourselves. Just like when you're building a castle with cards, with playing cards, and you like to smash it when you're done, or when you're playing a video game in SimCity, and at the end you like to destroy your city, or when you are playing with The Sims, and you lock your Sim between four toilets, or you leave your Sim at the bottom of a pool without a ladder to help him climb out. I think it's in our nature, and I think it takes a lot of courage and
looking at it from a different perspective.
Thank you very much. In order to achieve compassion in a way, or maybe not compassion but understanding, which is today extended to the word empathy, which is misused, but let's use it for now in this context. I think that there is hope everywhere. I think that if you leave, for example, let's say today replicants are a reality. Of course, we will have them working in mines, working as sex slaves, laborers, everything. Okay, we will have that. But we will also have people who will have empathy and who will project their feelings onto these creatures. Because we are only human as we can be. And You can't have feelings for a car. Well, I'm a car enthusiast, so anyways, if I see a Cadillac Eldorado, I'm like, oh no, I'm not gonna hurt you. But you can't have feelings for a kettle, for example. But when you are facing humanity, or at least something that eerily resembles humanity, you can't help but feel something. Either you're sending these creatures to death or suffering, or hard labor, or you are giving them love and consideration in return. I'm sorry, but I don't have anything solid to say about that. Because when we say AI, it's still a vague concept. You see, when you read articles in the newspapers that say, thanks to AI, we found some variation in the pulsars on the far end of the universe. In fact, it's just calculations. It's not a conscience. So, and I know I'm taking it a bit too far, but we are only human when we are able to be aware of ourselves in the universe. So that's a question that has been going on for years and years. I mean, take your favorite horse. Do you think that your horse is aware of being a part of the universe? I'm not sure. But we as human, as sentient beings, can do that. The day machines can do that, we'll be in hot soup, I believe. Because, I mean, a creation will turn to its creator and say, why did you make me? How did you make me? Why did you give me the gift of life? Why did you give me the gift of feelings? Why did you give me the gift of sentience? It's just like a child, you know? It's like, why? So that's my answer for that. And my answer is, I can't answer you properly other than giving you a general feeling of what I see right now. But believe me, when we have sentient machines, when they are self-aware, you will not be able to force them to work as sex slaves or hard laborers, you know, it will be impossible. Because nobody can accept that. Nobody can accept to live such a life of suffering in a way, and sadness and seediness and dereliction and a feeling of a being abandoned all the time. Especially when the people who abandoned you are your creators. We as humans have a chance because we are living in a world in which we say, oh, God is here or God is not here. But if the sentient machines, sentient creations, achieve full sentience, they will know that the creators are here. That is to say, us. What we will tell them, I don't know. I don't know, and I'm not feeling too comfortable about that, really. Sorry for the long answer.
No,
I go on and on about that.
If I'm going to be honest, that's one of the favorite answers I've gotten so far in doing this.
Thank you.
So I mentioned earlier you're a huge fan of Killer 7.
Oh, yes.
And for the track Electronic Snow, you were trying to get the go-ahead to be allowed to sample it, and while the creator, Suda51, said it was fine, and...
Goichi.
Yes. Said yes, and according to you, he even got to hear it. The publisher Capcom said no, and you ultimately had to make your own synth speech samples to work around them. Can you describe your first experience with that game?
Man, wow. It was a slap in the face. I had never experienced something like that. Because I like when you pile up mysteries, and I like when you end up explaining the mysteries. Some things are still veiled in Killer 7, a group of professional assassins, but when you look at it and when you replay it, everything is explained in a way. So yeah, that was a slap in the face. And I played it through just for 1 week. I only played that, I had the Japanese version, I couldn't understand shit. Then I bought the European version and it was wow. It's one of the games that left a strong impression on me, and it still does. I play it once a year. Every summer in June or July, I pop it in the GameCube and play it.
I take it you're pumped that Killer 7 is finally getting a re-release on Steam then?
Yes, yes and no. Yes, because people who didn't play the game yet we'll have to experience it in the best conditions possible. Mm-hmm. And no, because I don't care, it's just another version. And no, because for me it's just another version of Killer 7, which I will be buying, of course.
Back in January, you said in an interview that you were drifting away from synthwave because outside of a few talented producers, synthwave has become really boring, shallow, monotonous, and bland.
Yeah, that's what I said, yeah. I remember.
What would you say is the one thing that's contributed most to what you perceive to be stagnation within the genre?
Laser grids, neons, 1980-something, signed side-chained bass over the same Lindrum kick, monotony and repetition of a quick and easy pattern, and no sense of experimentation. But I'm being too mean by saying this because there are some people who discover synthwave today and they love that gimmick. So I'm not blaming anybody for playing that gimmick over and over and over again. It's just that after you've seen one Miami Beach Knight Rider in 1984, you've seen them all. After you've seen neonized Rider, Walkman, Carburetor of Death, Laser Highway, you've seen them all, you've heard them all. That's all. It's just that it gets old pretty quickly, to be honest. So, but I'm guilty as charged, you know, because I don't remember. You know, I did this on the Rêverie EP, but I did it once. Only once. And then I moved on to something else.
Pepperoni Auto Drive was enough for you?
Yeah, yeah. Was more than enough for you, yeah. I mean, but you know the story of Pepperoni Auto Drive?
It was supposed to be a collaboration with you and Vincenzo Salvia, and it's a joke between the two of you where you renamed Kavinsky songs, right?
You're so very documented. Yes, that's true. And but I did it for fun, actually. It's but people who are into synthwave and softer and mellow stuff like this EP a lot, and they want me to write more, but no, I don't want. It's funny as it is, you know, the track called A Happy Man or the track Paper Plane are very tranquil,
yep,
quiet, almost placid tracks. So that's more than enough for me, you know. If people enjoy what they hear, it's all that matters. The rest is horseshit. Horseshit or horse crap? How do you say? Horseshit, yeah.
Horseshit, horse crap, they all work in America.
Donk, whatever. Okay, all right.
I guess to end on a positive note, is there any artist, I know you mentioned Noir Deco, in the scene who you believe is doing something fresh and exciting, who deserves a bit more notice?
It's difficult for me to answer, because I don't listen to synthwave on a daily basis, and I don't want to. I could tell you what my friends do, like Perturbator, who is going in a really weird way, believe me, but weird but good. Weird but good. And Carpenter Brut, who softened the edges, if I dare say so, which is cool. But it's just big names that everybody knows. Ghost is doing interesting things as well, you know, taking his music into different directions all at once and doing it greatly. No, I'm sorry, I can't answer you. You know, I'm a grumpy guy when it comes to music. okay, let me give you this analogy in a way. I have a bookshelves in my house. I have 120 books. Mm-hmm. But I always get back to reading the same 10 books because I'm grumpy, grouchy, and and I don't want to step out of my comfort zone. But I know there are, but I can't help buying books. And I think it's the same for music for me. You know, I get back to my old classics. And there is excellent music being released every day. It's just that I'm too lazy and too grouchy to listen to it. I'm lazy, to put it simply. I'm way too lazy. And the last thing I do when I get back home after touring or concerts is listening to music. Or, well, except for my old classics. Sorry, it's not an elegant answer, but that's my answer.
I mean, 19 out of 20 answers being elegant, I think you can go with one not elegant answer.
Thank you.
That does it for me. Anything else you want to add?
No, I'm fine.
All right. Well, again, thank you for doing this. I really enjoy doing this with you.
Oh, that's likewise, sir. Likewise. Ce fut un plaisir, as we say in French. It was a pleasure.